This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
If you've listened to me on the radio before, you probably have noticed I have an itty-bitty obsession with the history of horsemanship. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. Of course, I wrote about it extensively in my first book with Dr. Robert M. Miller, The Revolution in Horsemanship. And whenever possible, I like to have guests on the show who can reflect a bit on that. My guest today is one of those folks, Patrick Hooks. He is a real live working cowboy, still makes his living on the back of a horse working with cattle, and he subscribes to the what is known as the hackamore system, or California system of bridling a horse. Also, the bozal. A lot of people equate it to the use of the bozal, the nose piece that is used instead of a snaffle bit to start the young horses. It's a time-honored system, a very complex system in terms of how long it takes to finish a horse in this method. 6-7 years is not unusual. And it takes a real commitment. Frankly, this method is kind of dying out. So I always try and do my part to keep it alive in any way we can. So Patrick Hooks is here today. He's going to talk about it in the context of ranch horse training. And we are delighted to have him here. This was part of the Horse Show Live, our expo appearance at the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo in Albany, Oregon earlier this year. And, of course, that's where we get most of our content for the radio show is interviews that I do at horse expos. And I love it. I learn so much. And, of course, it's a great opportunity to meet all of my listeners and viewers and shake a lot of hands and look people in the eye and kind of see what they're made of. And, you know, I have the best audience out there. I just really do. And it's always a blessing for me to be able to connect with all of you at these horse expos and gather material for my show as well. If you'd like to see where I'm going to be in the coming months, of course, the place to do that is my website, thehorseshow.com or ricklamb.com. Just click that button there for calendar, and you will find what you need. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
For 60 years, the United States Pony Club has been developing character, leadership, confidence, and a sense of community in youth through a program that teaches the care of horses and ponies, riding, and mounted sports. Red Brand Fence is proud to support these initiatives as the official education sponsor of Pony Club. Through Red Brand's Fence 101 curriculum, Pony Club members can learn correct selection and installation of fence, helping to keep their horses and ponies safe and secure. Learn more by clicking on the Pony Club button at redbrand.com.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition.
Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need.
Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo in Albany, Oregon. I'm Rick Lamb, and this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. My guest for this section of our show is Patrick Hooks. Pat, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that.
Tell us a little bit about your background.
My background comes from the legacy of Mr. Bill and Mr. Tom through Ray Hunt.
Dorrance's,
and Bill Black.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. I've learned a whole lot from the horse. Live in Tuxoma, Oklahoma, up in the Panhandle. One of the few places you can still make a living horseback. We raise Angus cattle, and I started cowboying out there. I rode pens and doctored cattle for a living for quite some time.
Mm-hmm. How did you first hear about Tom Dorrance and Ray Hunt and this whole way of working with horses?
Through Bill Black, and then anybody, for that matter, in the early 80s, it picked up any kind of magazine, had to have seen Mr. Ray and mm-hmm. Mr. Tom, Mr. Bill's picture. So, mm-hmm.
So did you have a particular mentor, somebody that that really took you under their wing and helped you along?
Yes, sir. Bill Black did. Bill was an Arizona cowboy, and Bill went back another generation, and he learned a lot from Ed Connell, Mervyn Takus, Marvin Myers. And a lot of those same gentlemen worked the ranches in the Northern California and the Northwest Territory.
That whole Vaquero tradition then?
Yes, sir.
Well, you kind of adopt the dress a little bit with the flat brim hat and so forth. Is that something you're trying to kind of keep alive in not only your horsemanship, but your appearance?
Yes, I would be kind of proud of that.
How would you define the Vaquero tradition or the bridle, California bridle horse tradition?
To me, it runs much deeper than the horse. It's about learning not only about the horse, but about learning about yourself as a human being. You'll find most true buckaroos will usually share their heart with you. And they're kind of a quiet type, and they sit back and listen a lot and kind of try to take it all in.
Mm-hmm.
There's usually a tradition or a reason for about everything.
How do you explain to somebody that you've never met before what it is that you do? It's kind of an odd thing in today's world, isn't it?
Well, for example, like throwing the big loop, the ranch roping, I really enjoy that. I love to learn it. Everything is much more quiet. It's nice and slow paced compared to maybe team roping.
So you're talking about ranch roping?
Yes, sir, ranch roping.
When you talk about throwing the big loop. I've never heard that expression before. Why do they call it that?
Most of the loops you throw will be, I'd say at least 5 foot, 6 foot in diameter. You usually make a throw that's quite some distance, say 25, 30 feet away. The whole idea about it is being humane to your horse and to your cattle and learning to work them in a very proper way.
Well, you want to also catch that cow with the least amount of running around, not only for the humane side of it, but you don't take any weight off of them.
That's true. A lot of people, when you mention roping, one of the first things they think about is team roping. And let me clarify, I'm not against team roping. Mm-hmm. I love to heel myself. Mm-hmm. But the ranch roping is more about thinking ahead. You work with a partner. Certain shots are set up. The more difficult the shot, the more points you earn. If your horse breaks out of a trot, in some classes you're disqualified.
How would you define a ranch horse?
He's what used to be termed as a using horse. Mm-hmm. Depending on what you want to do that day, you go using. If I want to rope cattle, I'm going to use him for that. If I'm going to cut or sort, I'll use him for that. If I'm going to throw the grandchildren up on him, he's going to be used for that. He's just an all-around horse.
Is a ranch horse born or made?
Well, can I expand on that a little bit?
Sure can.
In today's market and industry, we've been society. And horsemen, we've seemed to forgot all the work and the effort that was spent in the 30s and the 40s, especially in the stock horse. of the men that bred these horses for a certain way to do a certain job. For example, take a good bred cutting horse. To me, that cow, so to speak, has to be bred into that horse. You can make a dancing horse, but you can't make a cutting horse. He has to have that in his genes. Really nice reining horse. That real pretty slide and stop, that's bred in those horses. I personally don't think you can make a horse do that. Our job as trainers and humans as stewards of the animal should recognize that horse's capabilities and be able to get the most out of the horse that we can.
And some of that, of course, is related to their conformation. I mean, reining horses have, part of them can get down and do that stop because of the way they're built on the hind end especially. So.
Yes, sir, I agree totally. One of the best places I've ever seen that explained was in Bob Loomis's book. Mm-hmm. He was the gentleman that come out that started explaining the theory of the trapezoid on the horse for mm-hmm. balance. Mm-hmm. I can't call the gentleman's name, but the man that done the sculpture for the horse secretariat, that's where that theory come from, the trapezoid theory.
When you do presentations at events like this and you talk about the ranch horse, what is it that you talk about?
Myself personally, my program is built on a theory of rear end, under, front end, across. That's the exercise that I use.
Rear end, under, front end, across?
Yes, sir.
Okay, explain what that means.
Can I expand on that a little bit?
You can expand all you want, Pat. That's what we're here for.
there's a term, and I would challenge anybody to look it up. If you look up the Spanish term, jaquima de freno, mm-hmm. in Spanish, which means hackamore to bit or hackamore to stop, that is a progression that is taught through years of work to the horse, which means he's going from a bow sow to a two rein to the spade bit, straight up into the spade. There's a series of exercises that I have learned that's working for me through the years that is broke down into stepping stones or building blocks, however you'd like to say that. And I call that theory rear end under, front end across. I separate in the horse's mind a set of cues to separate his rear end from his front end. In the beginning, we start learning how the horse's feet leave the ground. That, to me, is basic fundamentals. Then we learn how to apply our hand cues, our leg cues, and our seat cues in time with when the horse's feet leave the ground in order to help him. In the beginning, with the theory of referring to pressure, how much does it take? I will connect that rein to that horse's rear foot by going to an exaggeration of completely rolling his rear end under. The end result of that will be I'll offer the horse a better deal. It's still the same rear foot, and it's still coming under, only now it's going to be stopping straight underneath the horse. That's a better deal for the horse. Then also, like this weekend where we'll progress, we'll end up working a mechanical calf and roping the roping burrow. By looking for less, in the end result, the calf will stop the horse, but the rear end will still be under. The calf will turn back, the horse will turn back by watching the calf, but the front end will still come across.
From the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Patrick Hooks, and when we return, more on ranch horse training. Stay with us. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com.
Hi, this is Michael Martin Murphy, and you're listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
You know, I think that's a particularly appropriate liner to get us back into our interview today, because Michael Martin Murphy's a big fan of the ranch horse and of the California Vaquero tradition. My guest is Patrick Hooks, working cowboy, devotee of the California bridling system, the Vaquero system, whatever you want to call it. And he was just talking about the way he describes his system of training is rear end under, front end across. So basically you're wanting to get control over the different body parts of the horse separately.
Yes, sir. But my main thing that I'm looking for is I want to eventually stay completely out of the horse's way. Mm-hmm. But it had to begin somewhere. So the theory of rear end under, front end across is a means to an end. And also through this term we use, Hakima to Freno, you'll carry that back through the languages. It'll go from the Persians to the Arabic, and you'll find you'll end up at King Solomon's stables where the battle horses were trained.
I thought that was a vaquero
Well, through the Persians, come down through the Spanish people.
Mm. Yeah.
But it's very interesting to see how the language changes as you go back into history. So you can literally track it for thousands of years.
So you're drawing a connection from the vaqueros that we saw here in California, in Northern California and the West Coast and so forth, all the way back to the Spanish that, you know, brought it in with the conquistadors and so forth.
Exactly.
And
right.
Then even beyond that, even to beyond the Moors that. And so forth, to the Persians.
Yes, sir. Matter of fact, there's a lady by the name of Dr. Deb Bennett.
Yeah, I know Deb.
Yep. And she had an excellent book on that has some of those same materials in it.
Yeah, what was the name of that? It's something about the conquistadors.
You're close. I couldn't pronounce it, so I better leave
Deb
it alone.
Bennett,
so.
Those of you who don't know her should check that out. That's the book on the conquistadors. Well, part of what we do here is just to kind of open this up and make it a free-flowing conversation and involve our audience. So I'm going to step out there and see if any of you have anything you'd like to contribute. Questions or comments for Patrick? Anybody want to start us off? They're all looking at one another. Oh, we've got a brave soul here. Thank you on behalf of all of us for breaking the ice. Now everybody's going to want to talk, I promise.
Well, we've just recently adopted 2 Mustang horses. And in the perfect world, these horses would do everything, trail, ranch, much like you said. What do we need to do today? You go get the horse and you do it. Is it impractical for us to think that that's possible, or will we be able to school our horses to do essentially everything?
Are these horses, are they off the BLM? Are they not broke presently? Or
they're off the BLM, and they are right at the moment at a boarding facility getting some gentling and just some general
socializing.
Yeah,
with the human.
That's a good way to put it. Yeah.
To answer your question, yes, ma'am. I admire you for what you're doing. I believe that most any horse can be taught. It's a matter of how much time, effort, and money you have to put into the situation. One of the things we talked here this morning was basically there's 4 or 5 different tools that mean the same thing to the horse. It depends on how it's presented to him and how he perceives it. And your question goes hand in hand with that. Let's say, for example, that BLM Mustang, the only thing basically he probably knows about a human is he's had a drag line, he's had a tattoo, he's been in a squeeze chute, and he's had about a 1,500-mile trailer ride. That's the only thing he knows about a human. that horse will have to be handled a little differently than, say, a domesticated hand-fed colt. The round pinned at liberty, meaning pulling and pushing on eyes and drawing the horse into me to hook up, that's one way of rearing under, front and across. If I take the same horse and I throw loops on him and I develop a neck rope and I take the pressure of the rope and teach him to give to his neck muscles, that's still rearing under, front and across. If your Mustang, for example, had the drag line left on him and I work him maybe in a maze of trees or in a maze of a snubbing post, or if I hip lock him, I can still get the horse to understand that's rear and under, front and across, to achieve hooking up on me. If I use a snubbing horse on that Mustang and say I throw a headshot on him and snub him off and get up above his head and take my snubbing horse and work his hindquarters over and bring his front end back across, that's still rear and under, front and across. So what yourself and whoever's helping you, you will have to determine what situation you're in before you can properly help that horse. I've been and watched some of the exact same situations that you're describing. Some of the better horses I've trained have been BLM Mustangs. It just takes a little bit longer. And I'll give you a true story. Matter of fact, I've done an article about this. A BLM Mustang and this horse got turned loose. I kicked him out in a round pen. This fellow had watched a few videos and thought the round pen was the answer to everything. And he had another colt he was working. It was a domesticated colt. And his goal was to put the two horses under saddle. The domesticated horse hooked up on him very quick, like probably half an hour, put it under saddle. Everything was honky-dory, and, you know, you can imagine the pride swelled up in the man. Well, then the rubber hit the road, and here come the Mustang. The horse hooked up. The horse was very intelligent, but yet he couldn't touch the horse. It would look at him, but he couldn't get close enough to touch it. And for 8 days, he worked this horse in the round pen. And he almost got close enough to touch the horse, and then he got pawed down, and then got cow kicked for good measure when the horse went by. Under those situations, if he had left the long line on that horse, he could at least finally got to where he could have got to where he could sack the horse out. If he had developed his roping skills before he went in that round pen, he could have made a few neck shots, got the horse up to him to where he could have took a flag, extension of his arm or whatever, sacked the horse out. What his horse learned was he chased the horse for 8 days into the Mustang. That was like being at the Hilton. The horse learned he could outrun the human, he could get fed and watered in the same circle, and he never had to long trot for 20 miles to get food and water. So by understanding and realizing those other tools that were there, that the horse would perceive as the same thing, there could have been 8 days of emotion left from the horse's mental capacity.
From the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Patrick Hooks. When we get back, more questions from the audience, including one about some aggressive youngsters. Stay with us. We'll be back. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world, like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Thank you, Woodman. We're coming to you today from the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo in Albany, Oregon. And this is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. We have questions here for my guest, Patrick Hooks. Yes, ma'am.
What is the best way to keep a horse's positive attitude given all of the hard work and training they undergo?
90% of the time, folks will tell you that quit on a good note. There was a parallel question asked this morning, and my advice to people, if you can keep from getting in an argument with a horse and let him make the decision rather than you force it down his throat, you will usually find that you will be way further ahead and the attitude of the horse will be better. And here's why. I'll give you a hypothetical situation. One of the biggest arguments that I see that folks get into is, say they first get on their horse and was using an arena for an example. Maybe the horse feels pretty fresh, and I'm not defining a pitching horse. I mean this horse just simply wants to move. Most people, they're a little bit afraid when the movement and the speed starts. If they would simply accomplish being able to ride the horse at a lope and be comfortable with him, then they could prevent that argument. And here's what I'm speaking of. Rather than getting an argument about whoa-hoeing and going immediately as quick as the horse comes out, if the horse wants to run, guess what? Say to the horse, that's a real good idea. I like your idea of running. And then as he tires a little bit, you've let him make his own decision. Then you come back and offer him your idea again and say, I just wanted to walk. Would you like to walk? After a day or two of that, they'll kind of catch on. They'll like your idea about walking. But then, see, you didn't mentally crucify the horse for wanting to do what he wanted to do. You fixed it up so he could make the decision.
All right. Who else has a question or comment? Yes, ma'am.
We have a 10-month-old that's my brother-in-law's that I did some imprinting with when it was little. And then they're gone all the time, and I didn't have the time to do a lot with it since then. So it has like 3 months of hands-on. You could do anything with it. And now he's like a little powder keg ready to explode. So what is your opinion on that? And when you imprint horses, do you believe in that? And do you How do you go about that? Should it last longer than that, even if you don't mess with them a whole lot, other than like feeding and stuff?
I do believe in, so to speak, imprinting. I just kind of call it tender loving care. If I normally would take my foals, and I like for it to be with its mother at least for a few hours before I would get involved, because I want it to bond with its mom. I don't want to interfere with that. But as quick as I can, providing I trust the mare, I want to get with it and play with it. There's not a thing wrong with gentling. It takes a pretty good while to get a horse to where what I call you can throw a leg over it and go on. One of the biggest mistakes I think we've ever made in the horse industry was a 30-day horse. Whoever come up with that, they should have hung him. It's been my experience that maybe what I would call a hand, one cowboy, if he takes 5 head of horses, just 5, and he trims them, he grooms them, he rides them, and I would say 3 of those horses, he better have to where he can throw a leg over of a morning and go to work on, and the other 2 he better be bringing along. That will probably take him, this is just my opinion, we're talking about the using horse. He needs 6 or 7 months on that horse in order to be able to completely trust him to go ride that horse.
He's with another colt right now, and the other colt was not handled a whole lot when he was little because he just wanted to beat you up if you got close to his mama, even at 4 days old. Would it be probably good to separate the 2 of them since the big one kind of like feeds on the little one? Kind of, he's more anxious than the small one, but he runs him around. And do you think it's part because he's got testosterone coming and all that? Do you think that's part of why he's so anxious and getting a little bit dangerous? Or do you think it's just because, I don't know, he hasn't been handled as much as intensely as what we were?
Without being there to see the situation, I would give you a yes answer on both. If the testosterone's kicking in, there's no doubt about that colt is going to change. That's nature. Same way with teenage boys. You know, they don't listen to their mother anymore about that age. Environment sometimes affects horses quite a bit, ma'am, and my viewpoint on that is the good Lord he created Sunday school students and death row inmates. Some made their own choices. Some it was because of their environment. Maybe some got to running with the wrong crowd. But however it is, we have to learn to deal with that with life, whether it be the human being or whether it be the horse. I would simply get that colt back out. I'd go back to my basics, like we talked about those theories. I'd give him a job to do and put him back to work. And in your defense, and this is something that I feel pretty strong about, in the horse industry, we've put too much pressure on the shoulders of the human being. Is the horse your responsibility? Yes, ma'am, it is. But at the same token, a partnership is a 50-50 deal. The horse has to learn how to do a little something too, and he has to have a job to do. It's your job just to fix it up for him so he can make the right decisions and accomplish that. Work his butt off. Tard never hurt anybody.
Yes, sir. You got a comment.
Is the main reason that you use the hackamore to set up the future training so that you can use it along with the bit when you're transitioning to the bit?
Yes, sir. That's exactly right. That was what the old tradition was considered, going up into the 2-rein. There's been several people that stopped by today, and we visited with them, and I shared and showed them my Santa Barbara spade bit. Not only the spade bits, but even the good grazer bits, if you'll look at the top of the bit, it will be bent out. You can 2-rein up into a grazer bit just as well as you can 2-rein up into a spade. That curve is made for a pencil bowl sow to set down in between the horse's muzzle and the bit. What works for me, sir, on theory, I can get a lot more vertical flexation out of my bow saddle than I would ever dream about a snaffle bit. I'm not a snaffle bit fan. If I can keep a horse soft and keep him working in a pencil bow saddle, the idea to me is to let him pack the bit. He learns to use the bit on his own. I don't have a whole lot to do with that. I'm still riding him in the bow saddle, and I keep my bow saddle reins a little shorter than my romal reins. And so that is a conversion that the horse needs to learn. That's the term used, learning how to pack the bit.
Do you use the snaffle at any point in your training with your young horses?
Not anymore. No, sir, I don't. I'm not against them. I'm not trying to come out and say it's a bad tool. My goodness, there's so many of them. True tradition, though, there wasn't enough iron ore in Old Mexico to have made three of them. So, you know, it was done with leather work. That culture, that's one of the reasons they're such skilled at leather work. They didn't have any iron to work with. They had to work with leather. There's old saying Mr. Ed Connell had, you know, a fresh-mouthed horse. When ride him up into a bow saddle, when you first introduced the spade bit to him, he had never seen any metal in his mouth, so he didn't know how to reject it. As far as using a snaffle bit, I openly admit I used to use them constantly, and I got away from them. I just changed my opinion, and things started working a lot better for me with a bow saddle and traditional training.
When we return, more from Patrick Hooks. He's going to answer the question, how do you select a bow saddle for a horse? This is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72 from the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with a lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again. You know, a lot of people think that if you have horses, you have to put up with flies, or you have to install big spray systems or deal with stinky traps or messy tapes. Not true. You can use Spalding Fly Predators, tiny, safe, easy-to-use, and inexpensive beneficial insects that kill flies before they emerge and become a problem. Do like I did and find out more about Spalding Fly Predators. Visit flypredators.net or call 1-888-282-7262. That's 1-888-282-7262.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian.
To download the rebate, visit protazil.com. That's protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on four standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
If you know somebody who likes horses, do them a favor. Tell them about our radio show and television show. Learn more at thehorseshow.com. From the Northwest Horse Fair and Expo, my guest is Patrick Hooks, and we have more questions. Yes, ma'am.
Is there a particular type of Bozal that you would start a young green horse in that you could recommend?
Yes, ma'am. I would let the horse determine that. The Bozal actually works off the heel knot. The weight of the heel knot is what works the Bozal. Mr. Ed Connell said, if a horse is soft, leave him soft. So if I've started this horse in a rope halter and he's given me a nice soft feel or broke at the pole on a loose rein, however you want to use that term, but if he's giving me his verticals real nice and he's giving me a lot of nice lateral movement, there's no point in me backtracking and say going all the way to a 3/4 or a 5/8 heavy Bozal. I'd like to go to maybe a 3/8 or a 1/2 inch sure enough rawhide Bozal and leave him soft, keep him soft. That kind of goes with a question just before this about the snaffle bit. There'll be some times that if a horse, not all horses are going to make bridle horses. And you, if a horse won't give you his head to the lateral movement, a snaffle bit's a very good tool for that, to maybe straighten him out for a day or two and then come back to the Bozal.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm not talking about a young horse at 15, and we just took her into the arena, and everybody says put her in a snaffle bit, and she's used to hackamore. And she just really fights it. I mean, with her mouth open, she hates it. She hates the bit in her mouth. You put the, she'll stick her nose right in the hackamore. She just, you know, and go all day long. Is there any reason why you can't just leave her in the hackamore?
If it's my horse, I'd be glad to leave her in a Bozal. She's telling you. I mean, this a horse doesn't know how to lie.
What
the
do
horse
think about
is telling
a side pull?
You. I like the traditional Bozal better than the side pull.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like you hear. I was asked a question or two about the knots on the cowboy rope halter today. Traditionally, what that cowboy rope halter is someone took the back hanger off of a Bozal and tied a noseband on it with those two knots, and that's where your cowboy rope halter come from. And so this person asked, well, what do you think about one with the four knots on it? And I said, well, if I can't get it done with two knots, why I want four on there for? So. At least that's the way I think about it. Anyway.
We have another question over here. Yes.
I'm a new farrier, and the horse that I pretty much have to walk away from is a stud colt. You know, they're the most difficult ones I'm ever faced with. And but the owner has to do something on an everyday basis. I'm only there once every 4 to 6 weeks. What can you recommend for that owner, just on a, you know, everyday handling thing that would help?
The old saying goes, I feel your pain. I mean, I shoe myself, and there's nothing, I don't know of a more strenuous job than to crawl underneath a horse and him either want to lean on you or pull his foot from you. It's very dangerous, most especially when you go to driving nails and, you know, a colt won't be still. If that nail catches you, you could literally bleed to death. So I usually always take up for the farrier as long as they simply treat the horse halfway, you know, to where it's respectable. A couple of things I would suggest to the people. The first thing I would suggest is learn where the feet are at. And what I mean by that, something very simple they could pick up on. The horse, when he trots, is just as though his feet move when he backs up. Okay, the reason I said that is a horse is going to stand on either one or two of the diagonals. So let's say I'm wanting to pick up the left front foot, and we taught this today talking about cutting a calf. I'm going to back that horse up until he's standing on his right front foot and his left rear foot. That's that diagonal. In reality, he's standing on two legs. I should be able to reach down and pick up the left front foot with no problem. One of the ways I would suggest to the owners to pick up the horse's feet, I'd squeeze a chestnut. I wouldn't reach down and pull on the hair. I'd squeeze the chestnut. There's some nerve endings there that horse will just kind of automatically want to pick his foot up. Then one of the next things and foremost important things I would do, and this is a lot of truth about the using horse we were talking about and the ranch horse. When we work on the ranches and those kind of things, ma'am, we don't have time to tolerate that kind of ill-mannerness out of a colt, and we simply won't put up with it. One of the ways that we go about teaching that is we rope each individual foot, and we teach that horse to lead to us off each foot. That's also the way we hobble break our horses. And the way I would go about doing that, to where it's fair to the horse, I would teach him the conventional exercise now that's called at liberty in a round pen, to where the horse will hook up on me. I've got that tool developed. Then I would take me a metal Honda. Buck makes a nice rope with the Honda, the metal Honda. And the reason for that, the metal Honda won't grab the rope when slack is thrown in it. And the way that's worked is a horse comes into you. Say you're working the horse to the right, we'll have it on the right inside front leg, say in the beginning. Then as that horse starts to take a step, you pick up on that rope. As he sets his foot down, you give him back his foot and use that tool you've already developed of being able to pull in on that eye, and eventually within just a few days, that horse will lead to you off all 4 feet. If the horse cannot do those basics, it would be kind of hard for me to even want to fool with the colt, because I'm, as far as shoeing him, because I already know I'm going to end up in a fight. And that comes back to the question about the argument. I'm going to lose the argument.
Anybody? Yes, sir, in the back here.
I'd like to get some information on your hackamores and your Bozell. You made a statement a while ago about a pencil Bozell. A couple of things. Hand movement and working with a Bozell as opposed to a ported bit or a snaffle. Steady pressure, bump on your turns. Is a pencil Bozell more severe than, say, a 5/8 or a 3/4? What's the difference in a 16 plat and a 32 plat? How do you adjust the nose band on it with the heel knot and the McCarty? And do you have any information on tying those knots?
A lot of questions there. He's getting them all in while he's got the chance.
No, I tell you what, my hat's off to you. The more plats, the more number of plats would be the finer the workmanship. If you get up into, say, 16 plat, 24 plat, that more than likely will be made out of some very fine leather. And that Bozell is probably going to cost you a little chunk of change, but it'll be something you'll be very proud of. For that kind of money, that's the horse you've already got started. Maybe you're showing. You want it to look pretty, and you're proud of the job you've done. In the beginning, I usually go with an 8-plat. It's not so coarse as a 4 to where it would cut my horse's jaw, but yet the strips of leather are small enough they can be drawn down tight enough with a little bit of Rieta cream to keep it soft. That will work pretty good for my horse, and I don't have a fortune tied up in it. If I had a horse that's gotten kind of dull on his face on me, maybe take a half mane, half tail Bozell, dip it into a bucket of water. That'll make the bristles stand up on the Bozell. The horse will definitely know it's on his face, but don't be mean about it. But he will know it's there, trust me. One of my favorite Bozells is the sides of the Bozell, which that is what determines the size of the Bozell. It's not the nose piece, it's the side pieces going down into the heel knot is what determines the Bozell. One of my favorites is made out of half-inch nylon. It's nice, it's soft, it's pliable, but yet it has a traditional rawhide nose piece and a heel knot on it. I really like that. To answer your question about the weight of the heel knot is what works the Bozell. So say if I've got a colt maybe that he doesn't want to break at the pole or doesn't want to give me his face vertically. This comes back to the theory about not arguing with the colt. That's the colt I'll take like the 5/8 or the 3/4 Bozell. Your McCarty rein that you use on the Bozell should match the diameter of the bosal. That weight of that heel will be across that horse's nose, and then when he goes to covering ground and you're leaving his head alone, he will automatically learn on his nose to start dipping his nose, on his own to dip his nose. Let me see what else you asked. A pencil bow sow is very small. It'll normally be under 3/8 of an inch. And if you really get down to the nitty gritty, I do believe that tradition teaches that a true hackamore is under 3/8 of an inch. To be into a true bow sow is under 3/8 of an inch. Normally, once you get a colt working really good in a half inch and get down in your pencil bow sow, maybe the next year you can start thinking about the two rein pretty good. To expand on that a little bit, some people, and myself included, are a little bit afraid to pull the trigger on putting a horse up into the two rein. Once he's working pretty nice into the bow sow, I don't see anything wrong with a 4 or 5 year old letting him go ahead and start packing the bit. I wouldn't work him in the bit as far as moving my roll mile reins, but I would definitely work the bow sow. A horse that's left in a snaffle or a bow sow too long, eventually you as the trainer, you're going to lose part of that softness. And if you start to lose that, if you stay there too long, you'll sour your horse. So you're better to go on up into the curb bit. You can two-rein him up into that just as easy as you could a spade. If you're not willing to humble yourself and openly admit, you know, hey, I didn't invent the wheel, I'm just trying to grease it pretty good, and respect your elders and where you come from, then you're not very deserving of it.
Do you have a website?
Yes, sir, I do. HooksHorseRanch.com.
HooksHorseRanch.com.
Yes, sir.
Is that correct?
That's correct.
My guest has been Patrick Hooks. Patrick, thank you for being with us today. Thank all of you for coming.
Thank you, folks.
And there you have it, folks. Before we close, I want to make one final comment. A lady earlier in the program mentioned imprinting, and she said she had some problems with a horse becoming aggressive. She was not doing Dr. Miller's imprint training. If you're interested in learning the correct way to do that, go to his website, robertmmiller.com. Remember, imprint training is a training regimen. It's not just loving on a newborn baby. That will get you in trouble. Dr. Miller's method always works. Check it out. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Land.